And we are back on Capitol Tonight. On Earth Day this year, Governor Cuomo announced that he was directing the DEC to launch a green initiative program using money from the state's Environmental Protection Fund to fund the Pollution Prevention Institute, which is based at RIT in Rochester. The idea here is to help businesses reduce pollution by starting at the source, providing experts to work with businesses to find better ways to manufacture products as opposed to putting forth regulations on businesses at the back end to control pollution. It's very interesting. Anahita Williamson is the director of the Pollution Prevention Institute. She's joining me in the studio this evening. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you for having me.
I appreciate it. So the idea, it seems so logical. For some reason, I don't know why people, it hasn't been a focus. It's very hot now. But the idea is to reduce pollution at the front end so you're not regulating it and trying to control it, contain it, and treat it at the back end, right?
Exactly, that's right. And we have an overall goal and mission to reduce the environmental footprint in New York State. And we are located in Rochester, New York.
Yep.
So we have partnerships to carry this out. We're partnered with four universities, obviously RIT, Clarkson, University at Buffalo, mm-hmm. and RPI, and 10 manufacturing extended partnerships, the MEPs that are located throughout the state. And like you said, Liz, it's exactly that. It's how do we focus on a process? How do we collaborate with industry so that we don't have to focus on end of pipe, regulations, compliance? We really have the luxury to focus further upstream and look at green engineering, pollution prevention, and really talk about how do we implement, first, how do we develop and implement innovative new technologies that we can put into New York State industries.
Do you find that a tough sell? Because, for example, just this morning, actually, Buffalo was ranked in a list of manufacturing as number 18 mm-hmm. in manufacturing, which caught me by surprise a little bit because you read about sort of the Rust Belt and manufacturing is dead and we're not making anything mm-hmm. anymore. But there is quite a bit of manufacturing, and a lot of it's, for lack of a better term, old school. So mm-hmm. I wonder if you have a trouble trying to convince these guys, if you just change stuff a little bit at the front, you're going to save yourself a lot of time and money at the end.
You know, it's a lot easier than you may think, and some of that is being able to work with the companies to be able to come in and do an assessment to actually show them where there's opportunities. And we do screenings. I mean, we try to identify what kind of information do they have available, how well do they understand their process, and really look for those big hitters. Where are those high costs when it comes to the environmental waste streams, and how can we really focus our efforts and go deep enough into the project where we can come up with implementable solutions that are cost effective. And I think that's where we're able to make the big sell, is the work that we do has a payback that meets their needs.
You have a couple of case studies that you've written about. Mm-hmm. One of them has to do with an etching company.
Yes.
Is that right? So at the beginning, they created a lot of acid. I mean, you mm-hmm. use acid to etch, mm-hmm. and they had a lot of sort of old acid that mm-hmm. was no longer useful mm-hmm. at the end. It sort of it had exceeded its life, and then they had to get rid of it,
right.
and it was toxic.
Right.
So you guys helped them extend the life of the acid, is that how it works?
That's exactly right. So we went in, we did an assessment, and they were very concerned about their disposal costs of this hazardous waste stream, which sure. came from that acid bath. And what I often get, this is a perfect example, that you know, going green may be a lot more green, and I don't buy it at all. I think there's a lot of opportunity to just address best practices within an industry. And we did just that. We studied their process. We understood the chemistry of that bath. And we actually did a feasibility study. We came in, we were able to prove to them that if they are able to understand the chemistry, we can manipulate it in a way where they don't have to dump that bath every few weeks. They can actually leave it there and it'll have the same results and dump it, you know, once every 4 to 6 months. Well, that's a huge difference in hazardous waste costs and overall costs.
Yeah, and it's good for the environment.
Very good for the environment.
To boot, at
absolutely.
The end. So who pays for that? And how do the people find you? In other words, do yeah. you pitch them or do they come to you? The state, obviously, as I mentioned, is involved here. They're funding you yeah. in part.
Yeah.
But you have also these university partners. So how does it all work financially?
Sure. Well, the state's been very supportive. I have a lot of respect for the efforts that they're doing with the environment and energy at this time, and they've invested in the Institute. So we have funding to offset the cost of our work. The initial discussion with companies, the screening, there's absolutely no risk. There's no financial burden at all. When we get into the assessment, we define, you know, what is the work that we're going to do, what's the cost, and we write a very detailed scope of work, and we say, okay, well, the state's going to be able to offset your cost by X percent, and you will pay a minimal fee. So that's how we work directly with industries, and we're really boots on the ground working in collaboration with them to ensure their success.
So the state offsets the cost through what, tax credits or
no,
through direct
just
money?
Direct through the Institute. We receive our funding from the Environmental Protection Fund. It goes right. through DEC and then it comes to us. And then we have our core programs, including the Green Initiative.
So you've existed now since
2008.
Okay, and how many of these companies have you managed to help?
We've been able to support about 100 companies between direct client assistance and brief assistance, and many of them are small companies or medium-sized companies that don't have the resources, the EH&S resources, to do the job. So we're a technical resource for them.
So could it be as simple as, I mean, in the etching bath instance, it seems like you changed the chemistry of their product at the front end. Could it be as also physical, in other words, changing their production mechanisms? And that would require an investment, right?
It would. And so I think about 50% is best practices. 50% is probably some type of capital improvement. But we're very fortunate in New York State. We have NYSERDA when it comes to energy improvements. We have the utilities that offer incentives and are able to support industries in buying and purchasing capital equipment, especially when they can quantify the benefits. Mm. And we also have Empire State Development, so they also have funding for environmental projects. And through the Institute, because we have a great advisory board, it's very diverse, we have a lot of networks and connections, we can really identify the best way to help the company offset capital costs.
What kind of companies, other than this particular one that we had been discussing, what kind of companies are we talking about?
Sure. We focus on specific manufacturing sectors, from the chemical industry to pulp and paper, metals finishing, plating, like we talked about. Food and ag is a big one for us. Mm. And we did a lot of work up front to identify what data is available in the state, and how do we tie that to specific sectors where we want to prioritize our resources and our funding.
And it's science-based. That's what we're
talking
about.
Very science-based, absolutely. It's technical resource and assistance for companies to help them make environmental improvements, to keep them competitive, to reduce their costs, and we've seen some really great benefits.
How much does it cost? I mean, this institute, what's your annual budget?
So it varies year to year, as the EPF has varied year to year.
Right.
To date, we've received about $6.4 million, including some of the Green Initiative
funding. Oh, yeah, that's good. But all state, not federal.
And what we've been able to do, I'm very proud of this, is we're very aggressive in going out and seeking federal funding and external funding. So we've leveraged over $900,000 of state funds to receive over $2.5 million in federal and external funds.
So now I know you guys are not sort of policy oriented,
right? Not at all.
Okay, but it just sort of theoretically speaking, mm-hmm. and I know you don't have a position on this,
sure.
but you are not involved in the fracking drilling industry at all.
No, we're not. You know, we have our five core programs. We have the Green Initiative, which we just launched, which is focused on green jobs and assisting incubator companies and existing companies on the acceleration and development of green products. So there's so much work to be done. And with hydrofracking, I mean, it's not a black and white issue. It's very complex.
Yeah.
But I have complete confidence in Commissioner Martens and his staff that they're going to do a fine job in making the decisions moving forward.
But is it an area that you could be involved in some point? Drilling writ large, if you will?
In the future, anything can happen.
Sure.
And we really look to the board and to our stakeholders to help us identify opportunities.
Well, it's really fascinating. I don't know why more people aren't banging down your
door. Hopefully after today they will be.
Well, I want to thank you, Anahita Williamson, for coming in. I appreciate it.
Thanks.
All the way
it's
from Rochester.